চিনি আছে।
গুড আফটারনুন ডিয়ার স্টুডেন্টস।
গুড আফটারনুন ম্যাম।
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Very good afternoon. Please keep your mic.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon. Please keep your microphones on mute. Okay. So, as you know that we are conducting the 21 days student induction program for our first year students, batch of 2021. So, this is the second day today. And today we are having a motivational talk session with Mr. Tridev Kundu. He is the associate director of Flipkart. So as soon as sir will join, we will start our today's talk. But till then, I would like to give you some brief information regarding your induction program. So I have to share some brief information with you. That is, you will have to make a report each day. You will have to make a report, a very in gist form. Okay, you will make a report in gist, whatever event is happening. Okay, yesterday you had yoga, so you keep some snapshots of yourself doing the yoga, and you have to practice it every day also. And for today, suppose you have a talk session, so you keep a note what you have understood from there, and later you will have to submit that. Okay, at the end of your SIP.
Anand Baba.
Sir, join question.
Sir, join question.
Okay. Good afternoon, sir.
Hey, good afternoon, everyone. Sorry for being late. I just had to step out from another meeting. Sorry for being late.
Good afternoon, sir.
I'll prefer you call me by my name.
Okay, so can we start now?
Sure.
Okay. Dear students, today we have with us Mr. Tridev Kundu. He is the associate director of Flipkart. Mr. Kundu has 16 years of experience in supply chain domain, and I'm very proud to share that he is an alumni of our own BCRC. He had done his BE in electrical engineering from BCRC and then MBA from IIM Bangalore. Currently, he is working as associate director in Flipkart, and he has profound working experience across many industries like manufacturing, power generation, consulting, analytics, and e-commerce. So once again, I would like to welcome you, sir, for your motivational talk session today. Over to you. So please unmute.
Yeah. Before we start discussing, the way I have structured is, I'll talk a little bit about my life, my journey when I was a student, just like all of you, okay? Bright, young, exciting students, fresh getting into engineering college with a lot of expectations and certain, I would say, with certain thought process, certain ambitions, certain fear. So I'll walk you through what are the different sequence of events that happened in my career. What are the choices I made? I'd like to touch upon that as a budding engineers, what could be the key learning objectives, what you should focus on during your time spent at Visura Engineering College. Okay. And towards the end, I would like to share some, I would like to walk you guys through about how a typical e-commerce supply chain work, because I coming from e-commerce supply chain, and currently e-commerce is something as an industry much more prevalent. So I thought that maybe I will walk you through you guys that how a e-commerce supply chain works so that you have some idea. That's the overall kind of the way I have constructed this session. If you have some other expectations, do let me know. Although that is not getting covered in my presentations, but I can definitely talk about it. Okay. So that's how I have structured the session. I'll just quickly. I'll open the pages. While if you guys have some expectations, please let me know. That apart from this, were you guys looking at something else? Do you like to hear something? And of course, I would like to have a small session where we can answer to some of the questions which you guys will have. So we can discuss through that. Hello?
Yes, we can hear you.
Am I audible? Is the screen visible?
Yes, yes.
Yes, sir.
Sure. Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. So, first of all, while I introduce myself, I was the first batch of Visura Engineering College. Okay. So, now when I look back at college, I'm extremely, extremely proud of the achievement that we have done, the kind of infrastructure that we have. And we were always proud of the teachers. Okay. Because even during our time, we had a wonderful bunch of teachers, and the infrastructure was well in place, and we have seen a lot of infrastructure to also build up during our stay in college. So I won't say that we got the best in class infrastructure, but whatever infra we got, I think that was good enough for us to us to be successful in life. That was always there. Okay. So from that perspective, so I graduated around 2004. Okay. And I joined the college around 2000. Right. So from that perspective to now, I think a lot has changed. So you guys will at least, you guys will have the best in class infrastructure, the best in class professors, faculties, support staff, and other things which are necessary for your well-rounded grooming. And all of you choosing engineering curriculum also shows that you guys are ambitious. You guys want to do or want to invest your career in a technical domain. Since you are part of this fraternity, so I would wish you a lot of best of luck and good wishes, okay? Now, I would like to begin this journey by saying a line which says that whether you think you can or you cannot, in either way, you are right. Okay. Our mindset is simple at the same time, very complicated. Okay. Now, whatever you tell your mind, our mind tends to echo that thought. So if you say, I can do something, then your mind will repeat that statement, and you will eventually see a lot of things happening around. Okay. Similarly, If you guys think that you cannot do something, then unfortunately your mind will play against you and it will take you to a negative spiral where you will only think about I cannot. Okay, so this quote is from Henry Ford, and it's just a thought process which is there in your mind. And that thought process, if you feel you can or cannot, in both the cases you are right, because the mind will make you feel that you are right. Okay, now similar juncture I was when I joined BC Roy Engineering College, with lot of mixed feeling. Okay, at one point of time I was very happy and I was thankful that I got into an engineering discipline, because during that time the thought process was that if I join into a general stream, then the struggle will be more. I have to study more, I have to do my master's, and then only I can get a good job and all. And my thought process during that time was that if I get into engineering, I think 4 years of hard work full of fun and all, I think my life will be much more smooth. Okay, so that was the happy part of it. The not so happy part of it is that it's not an IIT, it's not an NIT, it's not one of the, I would say, the top tier engineering colleges. So what happens to the placement? Will I get the right kind of education? Will my career be bright, or my career will be flickering? So those kind of anticipations, anxieties, fear, and to a certain extent, some of those negative thoughts are there. I'm sure you guys are also going through a similar turmoil. Okay, that there is good that you are into an engineering discipline, and then the brand that typically people communicate about other colleges versus our college, there is a difference. And let us be honest, I cannot say that my college is the best college in terms of branding. But having said that, having been in a position like you guys as a student, I can also say our college can give you the right pedestal or the platform for all of you guys to shine very, very brightly in your future. Okay. So, BC Roy Engineering College, I did my electrical engineering. Post that, I got into, during that time, it was Alstom. Okay. Alstom, and it was mostly, I would say, as a graduate engineer trainee. Okay. And one anecdote I would like to share here is, during that time, Alstom never used to come into our college. Okay. So we had to go all the way to REC Durgapur to sit for the interview. Okay. So when we were there, even the written test which we were giving there also, we were doing it in the REC test center. And the competition was directly between BC Roy College students and REC. And I'm very proud to say that thanks to our learning, thanks to our teachers, I think five to six of us got selected in that competition along with the REC folks. Okay. So there were, I think, two girls and roughly three or four boys were selected. In that. Now, I joined Alstom, and then it went through a series of changes. It became Areva, then Schneider Electric, and I joined as a designer of circuit breakers. Okay. Now, when I was in engineering college, I was very clear in my mind that because I am doing my studies in a core engineering, I would like to continue in a core branch. So I wanted to pursue my career in an electrical company. Okay. And I did that for seven and a half years. But it's an important choice which you guys should exercise. How many of you are passionate to continue in core? How many of you want to still appear for IT companies? So it's up to you. There are different divergent paths. You can straight away move to jobs. You can do your higher studies, which can be either in the field of doing a master's in engineering, or you can pursue your MBA. Some of you can do your work in a core. Others can move into more of a computer science or IT oriented work, typically in an IT kind of a setup. Many of you can join analytics organizations. Many of you can also go into startups. So now the avenues are more. But my thought process during that time was, being an electrical engineer, let me spend some time in the core. And hence, so I was designing vacuum circuit breakers, working with AutoCAD, working with SAP, purely leveraging my learning from my college. Okay. And during my, I spent around 7.5 to 8, close to 7.8 years. During that 8 years, Alstom went through Alstom Ariba Schneider. It just changed hands. And I worked in multiple roles. So I spent around 3 to 4 years in only doing circuit breaker design. Then I went into a new factory industrialization. So I helped the business set up a new factory in Baroda, one product line. Okay. That was a brownfield project. I got also exposed to Six Sigma Green Belt, and I did a project of lead time reduction. And then when I last left Ariba, I was managing the end-to-end supply chain for the retrofitted circuit breaker line, where right from customer placing an order to final product going out, that entire setup I was managing. Okay, so that was the work I did. Now, after leaving BC Roy Engineering College and while I was working with Alstom, I always had in mind that I want to do an MBA. And when I do an MBA, it has to be from a top brand. Okay. Because during that time, I didn't do well in my joint entrance exam. Hence, my rank was something which did not allow me to be in IIT or NIT. My rank was suitable for BC Roy. And hence, I was in BC Roy. But I wanted to prove myself again. Okay. I always felt that I can go to any top-notch college which I want to, and whatever pedestal, whatever learning I have done through my engineering, I should add on to that, and I should do my MBA from a top-notch college. Okay, so I tried a lot, and after, I think I made 4 attempts. Okay, after 4 attempts, finally I cracked IIM Bangalore. Okay, and then I did my MBA from IIM Bangalore, with specialization in operations and strategy. Okay. From IIM Bangalore, I joined Genpact. So one key message again, which I want to drive you to you guys is, from your current college, from your current discipline, whatever limits you want to touch, be it an MBA college, be it a master's college in India or outside India, nothing will stop you. Your college is only going to help you, and it is going to just create a platform to help you move forward. Okay. So it is all up to us. How do we learn? How do we kind of train ourselves? How do we make our mindset to move forward? So like engineering college, I was a graduate engineer trainee joining Alstom. I was a campus hire, and I joined Genpact in their supply chain analytics practice. Okay. So I was being from a manufacturing setup, doing with power generation and I would say oil and gas kind of a product. So in Genpact, I was asked to lead the supply chain analytics practice for GE, but their manufacturing setup. Okay. Now, I spent around 3 years in Genpact after my MBA, and then I, so by that time, like almost like an 11 years experience I was, and then I made my first job change in my career. Okay. So moving from Genpact to Flipkart is honestly my first job change as such. And that journey was also because during that time, I'm talking about 2016, e-commerce was catching up. Again, I wanted to prove myself that although I come from traditional companies and set up like Alstom, Power Equipment, and then Genpact, which is a mix of consulting, analytics, and a business process outsourcing kind of a company, can I do e-commerce? Okay. But always I believed in a fact that if your fundamental knowledge and your fundamental learning are proper, if you have focused on your fundamentals, then nothing can stop you. Okay. And my transition from all these organizations to Flipkart was purely backed on my fundamental concepts, fundamental learning, fundamental principles, which I have always maintained during my learning and my career journey. Okay. So Flipkart currently, I just moved to a warehousing team. Earlier, I was leading the last mile part of Flipkart. Now I take care of, I'm heading the large format warehousing solution for Flipkart. And by the way, we have recently opened the biggest warehouse in Asia in your state only. It's in Haringhata, West Bengal. Okay. So that's my journey. Okay. In case you guys feel that that I was an exceptional student or I was very serious about my studies and I was only studying, well, I think the next slide should ease out, okay? I am not. So, the bottom left photo, this is me. Hostel days, during that time, we didn't have a hostel in BCRIC campus. So, we used to stay in, I think, ASP hostel, which was near the REC campus, okay? So, this is on the rooftop with a bunch of friends. This is when we met after around, I think, 5-6 years. The photos on the top are when we met for the first, I think, alumni meet. It was an international alumni meet in 2019 when people flew down. I personally flew down from Bangalore. There were people who flew down from various parts of the country. Many of my batchmates are settled abroad. So we flew down. So this is like my gang. Of which people who are in electrical, they will know. She is Moudas Mahapatra. She is a faculty in engineering, electrical engineering, my batchmate. And this is our, I would say, our machine lab. Personally, we spend a lot of time in our machine lab. This is Dr. Sushanto, the HOD for electrical, whom we lovingly used to call Sushanto Da. Okay. So, and this is right after the visit. So it was there in our college webpage, and I very cherishedly have written this photo. I felt really, really proud to see my my picture with my friends on the college website. Okay. So essentially, what I'm trying to say is that I also had the same set of things, or I have done. The same set of things which you guys will do. We had fun, we ate out, we watched movies, we studied, we fell in love with multiple boys and girls, girls for my case, and in your case, it will be boys for the girls, or whatever the choice is. So we did all. It's not that we only focus on studies. And most of all, something which I'm very, very proud of is I got a bunch of very good friends. I am very, very proud of my engineering friends. A lifelong network of diehard friends, okay? And it may sound cliche from Sholay's song, but it is like a Ye Dosti Hum Nahi Todenge. So I have a bunch of very close friends. We try to meet at either during pujas or during December, or sometime we just fix up and meet. And yes, I'm not in touch with all of them. But I have a bunch of 4 or 5 people from college days. Most of them you can see in this photo, okay? Whom we meet. And my college gave me this. And I'm really, really proud and thankful to my college for doing this, okay? Now, moving ahead. So, a bit of my journey. Then, few memories of my college days. Unfortunately, I didn't have a lot of photos because I didn't have a camera during that time. And when I was in my fourth year, my father gave me a 1100 Nokia, which was not a camera phone. It was a, I would say, monochrome phone. And we used to communicate by sending missed calls. So 3 missed calls means come out of the hostel. 2 missed calls mean today there is an emergency or something like that, because we didn't have money to work, to communicate also. Okay. Now, moving ahead, let's talk a little bit about when we are in an engineering discipline, What are some of the key things that you should focus on? Huh? While you focus on fun, love, learning, learning new skill sets, everything possible. But in a core engineering discipline, these are some of the things which will definitely give you, all of you guys, an edge. Sorry for making this slide very busy, but I wanted to cover some of the critical things. The most important and the fundamental of them is definitely your engineering knowledge. Whatever stream you guys are in, please have a very good in-depth knowledge about that stream. Okay? Learn how to first have a good understanding about that stream and learn how you can apply the knowledge from that stream in solving various complex problems. Okay? You know, across entire world, engineers are preferred because of primarily two reasons. One is their problem solving skills, which is my second point. Another is their analytical skills. So that's the two key thing that as engineers, people assume that you will bring to the table. Okay? So now to have a great problem solving skill and to have a good analytical skill, it is important to have a very sound base of your engineering knowledge. If your concepts are clear, you will be able to replicate your concepts, right? There are various frameworks of problem solving, and the way today's world is evolving, please be sure the kind of jobs which are existing in the next 5 years, the nature of jobs after 5 years will be completely different. Okay? So you will never be able to predict it. What job you will get after passing out will be completely different for people who are going to get into engineering maybe subsequently. Okay? But the key tenet is problem solving. If you guys are great problem solvers, if you can leverage your engineering knowledge to solve any kind of problems, then you have a right fit in this job market. Okay? Let's take my example. Huh? I'm an electrical engineer who studied machine design, who studied about various type of motors, transformers, who studied about, I would say, different types of circuits. Now, that learning of mine has nothing to do how to design a warehouse or how to do a last mile supply chain. They are not related. But what is related is the approach which I took to solve those problems, the key fundamentals which I have to gather to solve an electrical problem. I think a similar fundamentals I need to apply for solving problems in my professional life. Okay, I've just skipped one framework here, DMAIC. It's a very, very common framework which is used in Six Sigma. So whenever you guys at some point in your career get exposed to Six Sigma, you will hear about the framework DMAIC. DMAIC essentially talk about 5 steps. You define the problem, you measure to quantify the problem, you analyze the problem, you come with a solution or improvement, and then you control that improvement. Okay? So define, measure, analyze, improve, and control. That is one very simplified framework which you can always use to solve any problem that you face in your life. Okay? The third important thing is, being engineers, I would say that being technology savvy, being savvy towards how things work, what happens if I do this, it comes naturally to us. Okay? Hence, you guys should be very, very conversant with the uses of modern tools and modern technologies. Okay? Which can be a hardware platform, it can be a software platform, whatever it is. So things like when you graduate or when you go through your engineering discipline, make sure you guys learn about Excel. Make sure you guys learn about some of the analytical tools also. College may or may not teach that, but these are certain things which you have to additionally carve out bandwidth and prepare yourself. Okay, Excel is a traditional tool which is used in all I would say organizations. So being conversant with Excel, being conversant with some of the analytical tools is very important. I think in college you will go through a lot of tools which are very specific to the domains. Like we used to have a MATLAB simulation lab, Then there will be simulations on microprocessors, microcontrollers, and all that. Okay. So whenever you are learning about the tool, make sure you have the aptitude and the right mindset to apply and use any modern tool. Okay. Now, fourth important point is that all of us have to be responsible engineers. Okay. Whatever decision you take, whatever solution you design, whatever solution you propose, make sure that those designs are sustainable, they are environment friendly. It is very important because it is up to us, the onus is on us as to how we treat our environment and what kind of environment we have to live for the next generation. Okay. Another very important skill set is ethics. Okay, ethics, being conscious about environment, are perhaps not the skill sets you learn in engineering, but when you are going through your engineering curriculum, make sure that you build up your own ethical personality. Okay. You build up your own way of life. Okay. Moving ahead, another critical element which you should definitely learn and leverage during your engineering is the ability to work in a team. Okay. I think in our time and currently also, I think in your setup, our entire lab process was a team effort, right? So we used to break up into groups of 4 or 5, and then there was a role distributed for each of them. So one guy will do the measurement, one guy will run the system, another person will change the circuitry. So that's the third person or the fourth person will create the project report and all that. That's typically how we used to do the work breakdown structure, the distribution of work. Okay, this teamwork is very important because wherever you go, essentially, you will work in a team. So learn about the fundamentals of working in a team. Try to be in teams which are, don't always be in a team which is with your friends. I think in our days, mostly the team was formulated by according to roll numbers. But if there is a provision, I would say, try to have jumbled teams across different years. The reason is the key learning that you should get from that is it doesn't matter whatever is the team. You should learn how to operate with team with multiple character types, because in your work life, in your career journey, you will work with team from diverse background, from diverse cultures, and in some cases, diverse geographies. Okay? So, when you are forming your team, if there is an opportunity, try to form teams which are not always your preferred choice. Okay. Moving ahead, another critical part of while you are going through engineering is focus on your communication. Communication is very important, both verbal as well as written. Okay. Written communication, the few exposures of written communication will come first. How you prepare your resume, how you represent yourself, and verbal communication will be very, very important. How you interact, what kind of how do you interact with your subordinates, how do you interact with your seniors, what do you have to communicate to the leaders and all. So while you are going through your engineering discipline, I would request all of you to also spend enough time focusing on your communication, right? As you move ahead, you will also get to learn about project management, the different phases of project management, because when you get into a real life engineering work, essentially you will be member of a project, and gradually as you graduate, you will soon be leading projects as a project leader. So try to have a good understanding around how projects are run. And lastly, and definitely not the least, as engineers and as students of BCREC, I request all of you, and I feel that all of you will be lifelong learner. In today's highly volatile, uncertain, chaotic world, one thing what will protect you guys is your ability to self-learn and your ability to learn lifelong for your entire career journey. Okay, you have to continuously learn. You have to continuously upgrade yourself. Okay, so these are few key tenets My last section will be around e-commerce. But before I jump there, any questions so far? Sorry, I am not able to see if there are any comments on the chat window. Any questions so far? Okay. So if I don't see any question, then I'll assume that so far we are good to go. I'll move to the next section, which is around just walking you guys through what is e-commerce industry. How will you prepare for your semesters? Okay, I think the best way to prepare for your semester is whenever you are going through your any of the studies, try to update, and this will not happen for all your subjects, but at least the subjects which you like, try to update it end of the day only. As in, like you learn something new, try to learn or try to revise it end of the day, so that next day when you come to the class, you have you already have a concept level understanding. It may not be deep, but you have an understanding around the concept and you can follow the class. Don't pile up things, because what I have seen usually, if you do it regularly, at least for the subjects you love, and especially the subjects which are core to your discipline, then end of the during semester, what happens is there is a bifurcation. If there are 5 subjects, then 2 subjects will be that you are well prepared, and 3 subjects you will not be well prepared. So you can focus on the 3 subjects and try to find people in your group who will be, I would say, not all of you will be good at everything. So that was the setup in at least my batch. So there were people, like I personally was not very good at mechanical design, right? When we were doing Timoshenko and Young, I was not good at free body diagrams. But then there was other friends of mine who were very good at that. So I used to leverage from them. I used to learn from them. I used to tell them that, boss, you do this part. Why don't you teach me? There were certain things which I was good at. For example, I was good at when we were doing 8085 microprocessor programming. I was good at that. So I used to have sessions teaching people do that. Okay. What are the ways to improve our communication skills? Practice, listen to lectures, start writing down. Okay. Start writing down. That is one of the best way to improve the communication. Who was your idol at college time? Who was my idol? Actually, there are quite a lot of people who were my idol as such. It's very difficult to name a few. Okay. College journey, what are the difficulty you faced in the beginning of my college journey? I think the difficulty was that there was always divide between the it was first difficulty was is the first time when I was actually away from my parents. Okay. Hence being alone, having me, I have to do all the things on my own, that actually created a lot of challenges for me. So I used to face problems, but then gradually when I built friends, I found that to be much more easy. But I still didn't learn how to wash my clothes. So what I used to do is I used to pile up my clothes. And I think initially I used to visit my home after 2 weeks. So I used to take all those dirty clothes in a bag, get them cleaned and come back. Okay. Gate preparation and all, I think all of you guys are first year students, so focus now on the 4-year problem and then on the gate. It depends on your what your likings are. Gate is again engineering discipline. Now you have to be clear. Typically I would say a gate approach works when some of you want to be a professor, or you want to be in your be in a kind of a teaching kind of a setup. But purely my belief is, from a job perspective point of view, a bachelor's engineer versus a master's, I at least in my career have not seen that differentiation. Yes, I had a hobby. I used to do a lot of quizzing in my college days, and I won a couple of prizes in quiz competitions also. In the different fests we used to host. So there was Arohan was the name of our fest during that time. I don't know what is the name currently. I think there was a fest called Arohan, where in Arohan there was a general quiz, I think, where we stood first or second, I don't remember. What is the best time to do an MBA after BTech? See, unfortunately, in Indian setup, the best time is when you are 1 or 2 years of experience, because then you get the more money, I would say. But the realistic time is after you have around 4 to 5 years of experience, then you can leverage your MBA. But unfortunately, the way current society is, at least the current Indian ecosystem is, if you do MBA faster, I think the amount of money which you can earn is more as compared to, so somebody who did his MBA right after engineering, maybe two, three years after engineering, is today perhaps in a position to earn more than me who did his MBA after 8 years of engineering. Okay. Yeah, I think somebody raised hand. So, yeah, sir, how did you manage between hobbies and your studies? Honestly, I think in engineering, people don't study that lot. So mostly people study during before the exams. So I think there is enough time for our studies. Okay, there is enough time. So I don't see that is a challenge. Okay. Before taking more questions, I will quickly try to, in next 5 minutes, try to walk you through how an e-commerce industry work, and then maybe a short video of a Flipkart warehouse. How to score good marks? See, very important question, or rather, how to score good marks is not an important question. I am not here to solve your problems. Please understand that. No one can solve your problem apart from you. Okay. So all these answers, you only know. Do your research, do study, read papers, work with people. Yes, definitely you should talk with me, your other seniors, your other alums, to learn from their mistakes, to learn from their experience. But all of these questions which you are, many of these questions which you are asking, is something should come out from your own research. Because after all, it is your career. You have to take charge, right? How to score good marks in semester? Simple answer, do your studies, prepare well, do a lot of practice, follow what is being taught. Correct? But each one will have a secret formula. What I will say is a generic statement. Okay. But what you guys will follow will have a secret formula. Okay. If you enjoy the process of study, if you enjoy what is being taught, if you take interest in it, I think marks will come sooner or later. And even if marks don't come, yes, marks are important because many organizations set a cutoff to select people. So good marks are necessary. Being focused on study is necessary. But focus on learning. Okay? Make the concepts clear. And it may so happen that you may not get good marks. Like, for example, I can tell you personally, I never was very good in competitive marks, competitive exams. I never scored good ranks, be it at my engineering entrance or maybe even in my MBA. Okay, in my MBA also. Engineering, I got good grades actually. I had good grades in my class 10 and class 12, but I didn't do well in engineering. My MBA ranks were also not that great. My MBA overall score was also not that great. So technically, I'm not very good, at least at marks. Engineering, I passed with distinction because I enjoyed engineering. MBA, I didn't enjoy that much. It was important for me to do MBA, but honestly, I didn't enjoy MBA. I always take a lot of pride in doing engineering. Okay, I'll come to the questions. Maybe let me cover the section where I wanted to walk you guys through around e-commerce industry. Okay, just a snapshot. And by the way, I'll share this presentation. This is a presentation I have made for you guys, so you can feel free. So this is a block diagram of how a typical e-commerce industry works. Okay, here are you guys. Here are you guys and me, essentially the customer. Okay, so what happens is a customer typically will place an order on the e-commerce platform. So it can be a Flipkart, Amazon, Snapdeal, any e-commerce company. Okay. When the customer places an order, the order can be either processed from a facility called a warehouse, okay, or it can be processed by sellers. So there are two essential models. When it is processed by a seller, it is called a marketplace model. When it is processed by a warehouse, it is called an inventory-led model. Okay. Now, what happens is from the warehouse, through big trucks, the product will go to a place called a sortation center or a segregation center. From segregation center, the item will be distributed. So you sitting from Durgapur ordering something, the warehouse is in Bangalore. So from Bangalore through bigger trucks, it will first reach a Kolkata segregation center. From Kolkata segregation center, then the shipment will be diverted to Calcutta, to, I would say, Durgapur, to Murshidabad, to Bardhaman, to Darjeeling, to all other places, right? Now, from the segregation center, it will reach a location called Last Mile Hub. And from there, typically a guy will come in a motorcycle, scooter, cycle, whatever is mode, in a two-wheeler. And then they will do the delivery to you guys as a customer. So this is the cycle. Customer places order reaches warehouse. From warehouse to line haul, it comes to a sortation center, a segregation center. From a sortation center, it goes to Last Mile Hub. From Last Mile Hub, it reaches the customer. Okay. This is the leg which is visible to you. Now, what is the leg which is not visible to you is what happens in the back end. Now, when you place an order, how does a warehouse store those items? So there is a dedicated planning team who captures the demand planning, who captures the supply planning, and then basis that they predict how many inventory needs to be stored. That prediction goes to a brand in terms of custom purchase order. So you buying a Nike shoe, right? So I'll say that from Durgapur, I see that at a month level, there is a demand for 4,000 Nike shoes. So I will place an order of 4,000 Nike shoe from Durgapur, 5,000 from Kolkata, and maybe another 11,000 from Bardhaman. So total 20,000 orders of Nike shoes will be placed for West Bengal circuit to the Nike brand. And Nike brand needs to ensure that 20,000 inventory gets stored in my warehouse. So that when any of you places an order from Durgapur, Bardhaman or Kolkata, the Nike shoe can be catered to you. Okay? So this is how an e-commerce supply chain works. This is the warehousing process. I'm not going into the detail of it because I would like to spend some time, but I would like to quickly switch on to a YouTube video to walk you through a warehousing process. Let's see if the video works or not. Okay. So it's a Flipkart warehouse. Okay. Just a second. Let me do a cross check. Are you guys able to listen to the video as well as me?
No, sir.
Which one is no? Like you are not able to hear to me or not able to hear the sound of the
video?
Sound of the video.
Sound of the video. It's still not there?
No, sir.
Okay. Okay, then let's do one thing. Just watch it and I'll try to voice over. And anyway, when I share it with you, you guys can watch it from the YouTube. Okay, so this is like a security zone. Here they are doing their attendance. This is a Flipkart warehouse. See, items have come from the vendor. They are quality checked. Barcodes are pasted so that you can trace it later. Now the items are being carried to their storage zones. So you are buying it from one of the locations. It goes to the nearest warehouse. Now somebody will come and pick the item which you have ordered. So he's scanning the item, picking it up, putting it inside a tote. So it is placed on the conveyor system. Now the tote will go to a designated packaging station. So these are packed items which will now be taken to a sortation section. See, here they are sorted basis pin code. Can you see these arms? These arms are actually taking the packet and bringing it to a designated location. They will be packed in bags and then they will be taken to the last mile facility. See, these arms are actually diverting this. The sealed bags get loaded into that truck. And the truck leaves for their destination of to deliver the customer orders. Okay. And this entire thing is done by okay, this entire facilities are designed, people who operate are engineers like you. So that's why I thought of presenting this video. Okay, so this is what essentially you guys as engineers do. Yeah, Praveen, I think you have a question. Just a second, huh? Yeah, Praveen. Praveen, your hands are raised. What's the question? Tell me. Sorry, I am not able to hear your question. Okay, any other question, any doubts, anything that you would like to share or learn, or as in like you would like to understand that what I did when I was an engineer, when I was a student, just into my college, anything else? Yeah.
So actually, this is 5 and college will close.
Okay, no problem. So I think
at any moment, the net will be shut down, sir.
Okay, sure, sure. So, no problem. Sure. Thank you for participating and wish you all the best. Enjoy your college, enjoy your studies, and I think the sky is the limit. So you guys can do anything which you wish for. And I'm sure our college will give you that pedestal, that freedom, that learning. So please enjoy your time as engineers and enjoy your learning. That's the key message, I would say. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for
Thank you, sir.
So guys, just prepare. You guys just prepare one report. What sir has told and how to prepare yourself. The motivational talks told by sir. Just a small report for your understanding. What you have learned from sir. Actually, within 10 lines, and date wise, you just make it a report after 21 days, you have to submit that as a completion report of induction program. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir, once again.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.